Welcome back to Beyond Arduino. In the previous two entries, I talked about how certain peripherals of the AVR microcontrollers work. And while these simulator boards that I made are all good and fun, you should teach yourself to use an actual AVR microcontroller eventually. And since this series is titled Beyond Arduino, you most likely already have an Arduino board yourself, which runs using an AVR microcontroller. No worries if you don't have one though, you can still follow along with this video and get into AVRs without an Arduino. Anyways, the point of this video is to show you how you can take the rather bulky Arduino boards and remove all of the unnecessary components, leaving only what you need. This video will also show you how you can program these microcontrollers without relying on any of those USB to UART converters or even a bootloader at all. So in hindsight, this probably should have been episode 1. Either way, let's get into it. The first question you may be asking yourself is why would we even want to develop our project outside of the Arduino hardware and software? Well, the first thing I will say before I answer that question is that there's nothing wrong with using Arduino, and it does come with a long list of advantages, such as the incredible library and community support. The reason why I'm teaching you how to operate outside the Arduino ecosystem so that you can get a better understanding of how microcontrollers work, and that they will allow you to use other devices other than the ones that Arduino themselves support. You may one day have some sort of reason to use an underground microcontroller without any mainstream support, or you may need to shrink your project down by using an ATtiny. And what better way to start than with a microcontroller that already comes with many Arduinos? Let's take a look at the anatomy of an Arduino Uno. Unfortunately, I don't have an official Arduino Uno, but I do have this clone board that I made when I was first starting out in electronics. It's functionally the same, so you should still be able to follow along for the most part. The first thing that you'll notice is this large IC. This is the ATmega 328, and luckily for you, it is basically the most famous microcontroller thanks to the Arduino using it. Some of you may have an Arduino Uno that is slightly different in that instead of this large DIP chip, you have a smaller SMD chip. But if you read closely, yes, they are the same ATmega 328P. Unfortunately, this can be much more difficult to use. So unless you have the skills and tools to remove this SMD package, I recommend that you just buy it in the DIP form, although they are much harder to come by these days. I found that a suitable alternative would be the ATmega AA, if you really want to get one right now. The same goes for everyone else who doesn't have access to an Arduino like this. I'll put a link to one in the description if you really want to buy one. Anyways, for those of you who do have an Arduino like this, you can take something thin, like a screwdriver or a pencil, and push the chip up from the bottom. And congratulations, you now have a bare ATmega 328. The next logical step is to place the IC onto our breadboard. And the best place to start with that is with the device datasheet. The obvious pins are VCC and ground. AVCC is the VCC for the analog portion, so we'll just connect it to VCC for now. We should also put a 10K resistor between reset and VCC. If you did take the AVR from the Arduino, you will need to add a 16 MHz crystal on the X-tal pins, along with two 20 picofarad capacitors. Beyond that, the first thing you may notice is that the pins are not labeled the same as they are on the Arduino. For example, instead of pin 13, you'll now see PB5. This is because the numbered pin system is actually specific to Arduino. Just something to keep in mind. For now, we need to make sure that our setup is actually functional by programming it. Your selection of programmer can get pretty complicated pretty fast, depending on what you need it to do, so I'll try to keep it simple for everybody. For programming, you have three main options. The first is the one found on the Arduino, which is the bootloader method, which has the main weakness of needing the bootloader already installed, and it can also not program fuses. The second option is the high voltage programming method, which is where the programmer initiates a 12 volt pulse on the reset pin. This is by far the most versatile programming method, since you can use it to program everything, including the fuses. It also does not depend on the system clock, so it is useful for cases when you accidentally lock yourself out when using another programming method. Its only drawback is the need for both high voltage and also the very large pin count. This makes it impractical for use inside of an already existing circuit. The final and arguably the most useful method is the ICSP programming method. This stands for the In-Circuit Serial Programming. This method uses the ISP protocol to program the microcontroller. It can program fuses as well. This method's main drawback, though, is that you can accidentally lock yourself out of the microcontroller. This can be caused by either selecting an inappropriate clock source or by disabling the reset pin. and the only way to rescue the microcontroller would be to use the aforementioned high-voltage programming method. I will be showing you how to program using this ICSP method since it is the most practical. But stay tuned for the high-voltage programming method though, because I will show you how to do that in a future video. Anyways, how will we transfer our code on the computer through ISP all the way to the microcontroller? Well, for that, you will need to get an ICSP programmer. Nowadays, I use this ATmega ICE programmer because of its versatility. It can program not only the ICSP method that we were just talking about, but also UPDI and the newer AVR series, and also the 32-bit SAM microcontrollers. If you can afford it, I recommend that you get this one. Although I'm aware that some of you will not be able to buy something like this, so I'm going to offer you a couple of alternatives. The AVR ISP Mark II served me very well for a long time, and I do recommend it. Microchip no longer officially produces this, but there are still so many cheap reproductions on places like AliExpress that it is still fairly available at a pretty good price. Going further, you can also use an Arduino as an ISP programmer. This method is much more prone to error, so be prepared if you're going down this route. In all, I recommend you either use the ATmega ICE or the AVR ISP Mark II just to save you some trouble. You will now need to connect your programmer to the microcontroller. The pins involved will be VCC, ground, SCK, MOSI, MISO, and reset. The ATmega ICE comes with this handy squid connector, so you can follow along with this table of pins and connect it to your microcontroller. Pause the video if you need it. The AVR ISP Mark II does not come with such a connector, so we'll have to discern them from this 3x2 header that it comes with. Luckily, my AVR ISP Mark II comes with this neat diagram, so feel free to pause the video and follow along with it if you do need this diagram. And if you were wondering where exactly on the microcontroller those six pins that I talked about were located, well, we can return to the data sheet to find them. And here they are. The designations are inside of the parentheses. It is also worth noting that these two programmers don't power the circuit themselves, so you will have to power it on your own. Anyways, we should now upload an example to make sure that everything is working. For our test, I will create the classic blink example. The first thing you should do is connect an LED from PB0 to ground through a resistor. Anyways, to make this all work, you will first need to install the proper toolchain to compile the code on your computer. You have a couple of options here, depending on which operating system you are using. Most of you are probably using Windows, and in that case, I recommend that you go to microchip.com and download the Microchip Studio software, formerly ATmega Studio. The installation process should be relatively straightforward and should guide you through it. Afterwards, create a new C project using the GCC C executable. For Linux, you should instead install two packages through your package manager, AVR-GCC and AVR-dude. Make a new directory and open a new file called main.c. For both systems, the code itself will be the same. Here's the blink example that we will be using. Now, I won't explain the code here, but instead you should go watch part 1 of this series where I explain how the I/O works on a microcontroller, and I'll explain this example in detail. To upload the code, make sure you plug in your programmer and give power to the microcontroller. Now go to your computer and compile your code. For Microchip Studio, press either the green arrow or F5 to compile everything. You should now go to this menu, where you can select your programmer. Upload it and you should be all done. The Linux version is a bit different. First, run this command as shown on screen. This will compile the code for the ATmega 328P using a 16 MHz clock, optimized for size, into a file named exe.elf. Now this file is not in the right format. Instead, we need to convert it to the hex format. To do that, we use this command. The R flag tells the program to leave out any information involving the EEPROM section of memory. And we are now finally ready to upload. Run AVRDUDE with this command. The P flag specifies what microcontroller we're using. The B flag stands for our baud rate. The C flag stands for which programmer we're using. And finally, the U flag specifies where our data is going. And we told AVRDUDE to send it to the flash in hex format. Either way, your LED should now be blinking. There's one more thing that I want to teach you about microcontroller programming for AVRs, and that is the idea of fuses. And no, I'm not talking about those glass fuses that blow up when you put too much current through them. The fuses I'm talking about basically represent certain device options that can't be specified by the code itself, the most common use of which is to change the clock speed. Let's change our clock source from the 16 MHz crystal that we are using to the internal resonator to reduce overall part count. Since changing the fuses on the microcontroller is a bit risky, I recommend that you use a calculator such as the one I'm using right now. It allows you to select which options you want to select, and it will give you the resulting AVR dude flags. Like the calculator says, be very careful changing the options with an asterisk, since they can lock you out from ICSP programming. As for the calculator, I will put a link to it in the description. To upload the fuses, either use Microchip Studio or AVRDude. For AVRDude, the command is the same before, but you need to replace those U flags. Afterwards, we can remove that crystal. Well, there you have it, a full guide on how to transfer from using the Arduino ecosystem all the way down to programming your microcontrollers on your own. The best part is that these skills will overlap when you come to use other types of microcontrollers in the future. You can see my other videos for ways that you can program more than just a blinking LED. Anyways, I hope you enjoyed this video and learned something new. If you did, please consider subscribing so that you can see my other videos. Have a good one!